as more South Carolinians are now eligible for the vaccine. And this morning marks day two of the Palmetto State moving into phase two of the vaccine rollout that includes 16 and 17-year-olds. News 19's Eleanor Tabone with our vaccine team talked to parents and teens about receiving the vaccine.
I think they should get it.
Anyone 16 and older can now get the COVID-19 vaccine here in South Carolina.
My oldest, Lucy, just turned 17 last week. She has been vaccinated.
16 and 17-year-olds can only get the Pfizer vaccine.
No, I wasn't hesitant. We are a family that believes in the science.
Krista DeLong says her daughter was able to get the vaccine early.
She's been lucky enough to be hired for a job this summer working at a summer girls' camp. And part of that requirement is that all of the staff is immunized.
In South Carolina, we're very fortunate. Individuals 16 and older are able to consent to vaccination without parental permission.
According to South Carolina law, a 16-year-old can consent to any health service unless it involves an operation.
They can get birth control, so why shouldn't they be able to get a vaccine?
I am from the school of thought where any big decisions should be discussed between the child and the parent.
If booking through Prisma, 16 and 17-year-olds will have to call the Prisma Health COVID-19 hotline at 1-833-2-PRISMA or their Prisma Health physician to get an activation link for MyCart. Once they have that link, they can then register for a vaccine. If going through Lexington Medical, they'll need to upload their details, and Lexington Medical Center will input that into VAMS. Individuals will then receive an email from VAMS, which will allow them to schedule an appointment.
I am 100% for him being vaccinated.
Father of two, Craig Smith, says it's important his 17-year-old son, Chase, gets the vaccine.
He really wants to play college sports, in particular football. So I'm for him getting vaccinated.
While Chase hasn't registered for a vaccine yet,
you can rest assured it's something that we'll be doing within the next 24 hours.
In Columbia, Eleanor Tabone, News 19, WLTX.
I say it's a great thing. It's going to help you out.
CDC card in hand, Miles Martin was told he was the first 17-year-old of the day to get his shot at the Greensboro Coliseum, a decision he and his mother made together.
You know, I've had COVID, and, you know, I've had both of my vaccines, and I'm fine. We were staying with my parents. You know, my father has cancer, so he was a high risk. That was another reason why he couldn't go to school. So I think it's really important to get it, because it's not just impacting us, but it's impacting our loved ones.
We checked in with local health departments and hospital systems administering doses. Randolph County Public Health was the only one requiring parental permission for an appointment.
It surprised me a little bit, but I understand they're trying to capture as many people as possible.
Right now, 16 and 17-year-olds only make up 0.6% of those already vaccinated in North Carolina. Forsyth County Health Director Joshua Swift expects that number to climb.
But I think it's important that 16, 17-year-olds get the vaccine, because while they're not as at risk for severe illness or death, they are more active, they're more have more contacts, so they have a higher chance of spreading the virus to someone who may not be as lucky.
Miles has been learning virtually. His first dose means he'll feel safer returning to the classroom this fall.
I'll be a little nervous, but still I'll be happy because I get to see my old friends. And also, surprisingly enough, I'm actually kind of missing school a little.
Record numbers of Americans are getting vaccinated against the coronavirus.
The U.S., the most vaccinated large nation in the world.
Dozens of countries are now working to vaccinate their populations in an effort to end the global pandemic.
President Biden says that by the end of his first 100 days, the United States is aiming to have administered 200 million doses. And by May 2021, every American adult who wants one will be eligible to get in line for a shot.
That said, 30% of U.S. adults still don't want to get the COVID vaccine, but they may not have much of a choice.
The federal government can require vaccination and things like that for coming in and out of the country. Both the state and city can have vaccine laws based on their legislative authority.
Requiring a vaccine is a health and safety work rule, and employers can do that.
Bonnie Jacobson knows this all too well. The Brooklyn resident was recently let go from her job after refusing to get inoculated.
I was sitting at home and I all of a sudden just opened an email. I'm sitting on my couch and it said, basically, while we respect your decision at this time, your employment has been terminated.
So can you actually be forced to take the COVID vaccine against your will in the United States?
To be clear, the White House's chief medical advisor has already said that he doesn't think the federal government will ever make the COVID vaccine mandatory. However, powers at the city and state level, not to mention the legal rights granted to employers under U.S. labor law, may make it pretty difficult for some Americans to evade inoculation against the coronavirus.
This isn't as unprecedented as you might think. There are a lot of required inoculations which are easy to take for granted. Just take the chicken pox.
All 50 states and the District of Columbia have laws requiring children entering childcare or public schools to have some sort of provable protection against the disease, whether that's a vaccine or evidence of immunity. In fact, schools, from preschool through university, typically require a battery of inoculations before you can step foot on campus.
When I was the health commissioner in Washington, D.C., we had passed laws that required anyone who went to a school to be vaccinated against certain preventable diseases.
There are religious, medical, and philosophical exemptions that vary state by state. But for around 170 years, America's schools have done a pretty thorough job controlling vaccine-preventable disease in the U.S.
The very first school vaccination mandate was in Massachusetts back in the 1850s. It was to protect against smallpox transmission. By the start of the 20th century, almost half of all states required students to be vaccinated before matriculating. In the early 1970s, schools with a measles vaccine mandate had incidence rates that were up to 51% lower than states without the laws. And from there, school vaccine mandates expanded over the next few decades.
But while schools had been requiring vaccines since the mid-19th century, states didn't explicitly have that same power to roll out universal inoculation rules for all residents for another 50 years.
In 1905, the Supreme Court case of Jacobson versus Massachusetts set the legal precedent, which now allows states to require vaccines.
The Supreme Court said, yes, you can limit individual rights to protect the public health. And one way you can do it in that case is require vaccination.
We've seen states exercise this authority to varying degrees in the years since. Take, for example, the 2019 measles outbreak in New York.
New York imposed a mandate. It imposed an MMR mandate, but it limited it to the neighborhoods where the measles cases were high, and it was accompanied by a $1,000 fine for those who did not have MMR.
Legal experts say that narrowing the vaccine mandate to particular zip codes made it easier to justify in court rather than a statewide mandate. But critics warn that these types of targeted requirements may lead to discriminatory practices.
In general, these things are done at the state level, but big cities, for example, also have vaccine laws. When I was the city health commissioner in Washington, D.C., although that certainly functions as a state, we also had vaccine laws in Washington, D.C.
So far, no cities or states have made the COVID vaccine mandatory, though some places have started the conversation.
In November 2020, the New York State Bar Association recommended making the shot mandatory for all residents except those with a medical exemption. And then, of course, there's the biggest rulemaker of them all, the federal government, which in this case actually has pretty limited powers expressly spelled out in the Constitution.
There isn't in the Constitution the power to protect the public health.
Well, the federal government doesn't mandate vaccines. What they do is they make recommendations.
There are, however, softer powers at the federal level that have been used before to incentivize mass inoculation.
The federal government has acted in the public health in the past using other powers, such as its commerce powers. So it could, for example, mandate vaccines before you travel in the interstate channels or before you engage in interstate commerce. If you're a truck driver that drives across state, maybe the federal government can mandate that you'll be vaccinated.
The power of the purse is another key tool in Washington's arsenal.
It can pass a law saying states will give you $3 million if you mandate the vaccine, but that's up to a limit. It can't do it to the degree that's coercive.
The federal government could also, theoretically, impose it as a condition of getting a passport.
So states and cities can require vaccines, and the federal government has a lot of influence as well. So how will this actually play out?
Experts tell me the most likely scenario is a repeat of what we've seen in the past.
Once the COVID vaccines are fully approved by the FDA, a vaccine may eventually be a requirement for school-aged children in both public and private institutions, starting at daycare and extending to universities.
Let's say the city where you live decides against requiring the COVID vaccine. Does that mean you're free from mandatory COVID inoculation? Not necessarily. Your employer may not be willing to take no for an answer.
Jacobson was a waitress in Brooklyn and served patrons all through the pandemic. She told NBC New York that while she isn't an anti-vaxxer, she did have concerns about getting the shot because she's trying to get pregnant.
My general manager has told me multiple times it wasn't going to be mandatory.
When her former employer, Red Hook Tavern, asked if she planned to get the vaccine now that it's available for restaurant workers, she shared those worries.
Over the last couple months, I had just heard a few things about how it can affect fertility and pregnancy, and I just wanted to have a better understanding of that and do a little more research. I said that once I had more information, I would definitely be willing to change my mind on getting the vaccine. I expressed that, you know, I understand why they're important. I think that the vaccine's a good thing. I'm not against them.
Within a few days, she received an email from her employer saying that they respected her decision, but they would be terminating her employment because of their new policy to maintain a safe working environment.
You know, I've made it clear to my lawyer that I want to go in whatever direction I think will help the most amount of people have this same situation not happen to them.
He reached out to Red Hook Tavern for comment, and we didn't hear back as of the date of publication.
Jacobson's firing appears to be totally legal here in the U.S. I spoke with lawyers across the country, and they all say that their clients are reaching out to them in record numbers to ask what they should do about the vaccine.
Clients of mine that are most interested in making a mandatory vaccine a condition of employment are brick and mortar operations that have a lot of foot traffic from their customers. They view it as a selling point. Look, you can come into our business location and it's safe because all employees have been vaccinated. That's particularly important for restaurants, bars, gyms, and salons. And so my clients in that segment of service industry are particularly looking hard at making it mandatory as a sales point to their customers.
While this is in part a PR tactic, it's also totally within an employer's rights to roll out this kind of requirement. Legal experts say private businesses have pretty extensive rights. Requiring a vaccine is a health and safety work rule. Employers, like some hospitals, already require employees to get the annual influenza vaccine. So there's precedent that under the law, an employer can force an employee to get vaccinated, and if they don't, fire them.
Now to the other news we've all been waiting for. New guidance from the CDC regarding wearing masks. Fully vaccinated people are safe to not wear masks indoors. The agency says people who are 2 weeks past their final dose can safely stop wearing masks indoors in most places. The new guidance still calls for masks in crowded places like buses, airplanes, and hospitals, but eased restrictions for workplaces and schools.
If you are fully vaccinated, you can start doing the things that you had stopped doing because of the pandemic. We have all longed for this moment when we can get back to some sense of normalcy.
The new guidance also says fully vaccinated people don't have to wear masks at all outdoors. The announcement comes as the positivity rate is at its lowest point since the pandemic began. The news is getting a lot of reaction on social media. Belinda says she's going to keep wearing her masks even though she's had both of her shots. She says she'd rather be sick than sorry. Renee Winder wonders how we're supposed to know if someone is or isn't vaccinated.
The CDC also gave the green light for vaccines for younger kids, and now trial locations are giving the Pfizer shot to kids as young as 12 years old. But did you know, because of North Carolina state law, children do not need their parents' consent to get vaccinated.
Kids ages 12 to 15 can now officially roll up their sleeves and get the Pfizer vaccine.
We have had individuals in that 12 to 15 year range make appointments already. They were actually making appointments before
CDC
it was official.
The FDA decision before that happens. Researchers have been testing the vaccine on kids as young as 6 months old to see if it's safe and effective. Eloise LaCour is happy and healthy.
Here we go.
The three-year-old just received her second COVID-19 vaccine. She's part of a study testing Pfizer's vaccine on children 6 to 12 years old.
Whatever we can do to protect her, even though chances are she'd be totally fine if she caught the virus, we don't know what the long-term effects are.
Yvonne Maldonado leads the research at Stanford University School of Medicine. She says they plan to enroll a few thousand children to see if the vaccine is safe and effective. For younger children, they're currently working to find the right dose.
Thank you for checking out my video. Before you go, I just want to ask you a question that I wish somebody had asked me years ago, because now I'm very sick, and even though the last 10 years have been the best years of my life because I finally had a relationship with Jesus and just everything fell into place, I now just don't have much time left to share what I've learned with others. So I want to do that now, okay? That's why I'm here. I was so confused and miserable and deceived for such a long time about all the religions out there and churches just pulling me in different directions. I had tried so many different churches. They all said different things, and none of it made any sense to me. Until one day, I finally realized that none of that was true. Okay? I was so deceived, and I couldn't believe how much time I had wasted on it. I don't want you to waste all the years that I wasted, okay? So I'm going to make it really easy for you if you just give me a little bit of time. Okay? So I'm going to ask you this today first. If you died 5 minutes from this moment, are you sure, 100% sure that you'd go to heaven? How about you just take a few minutes right now and make sure that you will, and then from that moment onward, you can rest and have peace and not be stressed out, you know, knowing that no matter what this crazy world brings, and I know you know it's going crazy out there, okay? You can't watch the news without seeing all these crazy weather disasters going on, earthquakes and volcanoes going off, and people trying to kill each other. Everybody's divided. There's protests in every different country. This is a worldwide thing. You may not see the stuff going on in your own news, your local news, but try looking what people are uploading from their different countries. Actual people like you and I uploading that they've taken with their video cameras. That's where it's at. All right, you don't go by what you see on the normal news. You got to look at what's really happening in the world out there. The news people are trying to cover this stuff up. They don't want you to go to heaven. This is all Satan's system trying to confuse you and stop you from learning about God and how easy it is to get saved, okay? They're trying to make it difficult. But I'm going to show you how easy it actually is, all right? And if you could just put aside all of that stuff and wipe the slate clean, okay? What I'm going to tell you may not be the same thing that you have heard in the past, and it might not be what you expect. First off, God wants you to come as you are, no matter what you've done, no matter what kind of lifestyle you've lived in the past or what you're living in now, okay? Forget all that, all right? He sent his son to die on the cross for every single one of us. And I know a lot of people, including me, I was you, okay? At one point, I didn't think I was worthy. I thought I had done way too many terrible things and God wouldn't love me or forgive me. And that's just not true. Okay, that's not true. The whole Bible is full of examples of God forgiving murderers and terrible people. And not only that, but then he used them to go on to do amazing things. All right, so I want you to have that mindset when you're going into this, okay? First, I just want to read this little bit of scripture from the Bible because it's so important for you to hear this at least once. It's called the gospel. You may have heard the word, but not actually heard the actual gospel. And no, the gospel isn't the whole Bible, okay? It's just a little section of the Bible. It's found in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, and it says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures." All right, first, I just want to mention a couple things. Who's writing this right now? This is the Apostle Paul writing this, okay? He is a perfect example of how God will forgive anybody that actually comes to him, okay? Paul was killing Christians. He was persecuting Christians. He was on his way to killing more Christians, okay? When God stopped him on the road and was like, "Yo, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this, bro?" And, you know, he was misguided, okay? He just didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah. And then once he did, and he accepted and asked for forgiveness, of course, Jesus immediately forgave him. And not only that, but then he went on to have him be given the responsibility of getting all Gentiles, everybody who's not a Jew, get saved. He did go to some of the Jews, but then he went on to be the one in charge of getting the word out to everybody that was not a Jew. Okay, that's us. So unless you're a Jew, in which case, welcome, okay? We welcome everybody here. I want you to hear this too, okay? Because you might find out something you're going to be really surprised of, okay? Now, I want to just mention something on that last line where it said, "and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." It's really important that you pay attention to the fact that it said according to the Scriptures. Why? Because that is pointing out that this is prophecy being fulfilled. So if you are a Jew, this is important for you to hear, okay? Because it's saying that all of these things were prophesied back in the Old Testament. go through and you look in the Old Testament, you can see all of the details of the how the Messiah would be portrayed, how you would know it was him, okay? And Jesus fulfilled all of that, and he did everything that the Bible said would happen, okay? And then the Bible goes on to say all kinds of other things that are going to happen that are happening now, okay? So there's a lot of stuff in the Bible that if you're not reading it, you are missing out, because it's like a book about the future, okay? Only some of it's already come true. Okay, so I know a lot of people stop at 1 through 4 here for time's sake, but this small section that follows is so important because it shows proof that Jesus rose from the dead. Okay, so I want to include this little bit here, okay, that goes on after 4. Starting in 5, it says, "And that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep." Okay, so that fallen asleep just means they died, okay? After that, he was seen of James, then of all the apostles. James is Jesus' brother, okay? So for anybody who didn't know this, Jesus had siblings, okay? Not just a brother, but he had sisters. "And last of all, he was seen of me also, as of one born out of due time, for I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God." Okay, so this is Paul being humble and admitting, hey, I almost don't really want to be included in the title of apostle, because look at what I was doing. I was persecuting the church of God. I was killing Christians. But he was given this duty, so he had to do this. And Paul wrote most of the New Testament, okay? So now that you've heard the gospel, let's take a second out of your life to make sure that you can be 100% sure that when you are done here today, that you can know for sure that you'll go to heaven if you were to die. Okay, we don't like to think about death. Believe me, I've been forced to think about death every day for the last several years. And this last couple of weeks, I almost died several times. So I think about death a lot, but I think about it in a good way. So I'll do another video on that, what I think about while dying, okay? Salvation is meant to be childlike, simple, not complex like religions have led people to believe. So let's look at this like a child would. All right, Jesus himself said in Matthew 18:3, "Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven." He was saying here that we are born of our mothers and in this fleshly body, okay? But that's just a people suit, okay? For us to enter into heaven, we have to be born again in the spirit. When we die and we go to heaven, obviously this people suit gets left behind, okay? We get a new body. A really amazing, cool body. And part of the reason why Jesus walked around and was talking to people, he was eating with people, all kinds of stuff to show, hey, this could be you one day. You know, you don't just go to heaven and do nothing. You go to heaven in this immortal, cool body that eats and does normal things, but you just don't have any of that. It's like having all the good stuff about life, but and then some, and not having any of being tempted to do bad things, and you don't have the need to sleep or anything like that. You will never be sick again, never have pain again. It's amazing, okay? So he wanted to show you that. He had people touch him and say, "Look, see, I'm solid." He showed people the holes in his hands to prove, you know, look, I really was crucified, and here I am walking around, and I'm real. And he had them touch him specifically so that they would see, you know, like, I'm not a spirit. I'm actually me again. I'm just alive again. And so let's look at this like newborns, okay, like children, not with complex lists or things that are added by men, like you would have to come to our church or do certain works and stuff that they always add on. Because know this, the Bible tells us the exact opposite of that, okay? In Ephesians chapter 2, it says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Do you understand what I'm saying here? If you had to do some kind of work, it wouldn't be a gift then, right? It would be employment, Okay? Entrance to heaven is a gift. All you have to do is accept it and trust it. Let me put it into childlike ABCs for you, okay? Because that's what it was meant to be. A, admit that you're a sinner, because every single one of us is a sinner. All right, Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And also Romans 3:10 says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. So if you are encountering people that are saying that they're righteous or saying that they're not a sinner and they don't need a savior, okay, they're lying, okay, because every single one of us does, and every single one is a sinner. B, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Okay, that's eternal life. Everyone, anyone who believes in him, I don't care who you are, what you've done. Okay, we're all a whosoever. C is confess the Lord Jesus, because Romans 10:9-10 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. All right, remember that just saying the ABCs that I just read to you is not what saves you. It's you have to believe it in your heart. You have to really believe it, not just accept it in your mind. You have to really believe it. That's what faith is. Okay, faith comes by hearing and not seeing. Okay, you know, that's why we get such a good deal in this time frame, that we get saved in such an easy way, because, you know, it's not really that easy when you think about it, believing something that you've about someone you've never met. But there's God has given so many clues that he's real, that he will look at it as you have no excuse by the time you get there. There will be no being like, I didn't know. Well, first off, you're listening to this, so you didn't know. I'm giving you this really easy explanation so that you will be able to make that choice. All right. Nobody is sent to hell. Remember that. It's you choose. It's a press the Jesus button, press the hell button. Which one are you going to press? Okay. Wondering if you have to go shout it at the rooftops that Jesus is Lord in order to seal the deal? No. Okay, we're living in the day and the age of internet, my friend. Even if you don't encounter a single person because of this pandemic and stuff, I'll listen. Okay, just type it in the comments below this video, and that's confessing it publicly. All right, when I say confess the Lord Jesus, just confess it to anybody. Okay, tell a friend, tell a family member. In fact, that's the best thing you can do, because why not share heaven with other people? You want them to go too. So you'd be surprised how many people have the wrong idea about God and of heaven. So, and look how easy it is. That's how easy it really is. So maybe they've been confused too. So tell other people. Now, this is straight from the Bible. Everything that I just told you is straight from God. I'm not adding any other man-made stuff to it. You can see that was the scriptures I was reading, okay? This is how God says you enter heaven. And remember, God said that there is no other way to be saved, even though Satan is trying his hardest to confuse us with so many other false religions out there. You know, this is what the Bible says about Jesus, okay? Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. All right, they're talking about Jesus here. Oh, wait, there's one more thing. Remember how I said that after Jesus died and walked around showing hundreds of people that God rose him from the dead? Wow, okay. When he did this, he also told his friends that he had to go back to heaven. They were, of course, really sad at this idea, but he told them, wait, my dude, don't be sad. Okay, I have to go back to heaven for a reason. That's because when I go to heaven, I'm going to do the coolest thing. Okay, I'm going to send part of myself, called the Holy Spirit, back down here to help and guide each one of you until I come back to get you. Oh yeah. Okay, wait. Did I forget to mention that part? I forget a lot of stuff because I had several strokes. Okay. Bruh. He's coming back to get us. Okay. So not only do you get to go to heaven, but there's a really, really good chance that you won't die at all. All right? I'm dying soon, and I might not die at all, because God tells us that he'll be coming back and taking all of his believers, that's you now, up to heaven. That means you get to bypass death, all right, and get taken up to heaven in the rapture. Okay, that's a whole different video, but I just want to give you this. I want you to let you know this because he gave a list to watch for. And when we see those things happening, we're to know that we're living in the time when he comes back to get us. Please note that I've read this list and we're living in that time. Okay, there's been a check mark at each one of those things now. All right, we're out of here soon. I mean, I could tell you so many things, but this would take way too long right now. But I'll do some other videos that will explain that. You know, you just heard this, though, in the nick of time. I wanted you to get at least this part in, okay? It's almost like God led you here at this very moment so that you not only get to be one of those who get to go to heaven, but one of those who get to legit cheat death. What? What? I mean, how amazing, right? So, if you listen to my long spiel and you believed at the simple little ABC's explanation, then welcome to the family, okay? We are siblings now, okay? Woohoo! So please don't hesitate to write me anytime and ask me questions. Well, I'm not a preacher, okay? I never would say that I am. I'm just somebody that was, you know, where you were once, where you are. I was there, okay? And I took that leap of faith and my whole life changed, all right? I know some great preachers out there that I'd really like to recommend to you. And I can pray for you anytime. I can support you. That's what we're here for. And encourage each other in this really, really dark, dank time that's going on right now. But I'll link some people in the description box that of free videos that you can go to. People that aren't out there just to make money that are actually just out there to share the Bible, okay? And some of them are really easy to understand. And other ones that I'll link are churches that upstream. I don't think that's the right terminology, but I'm sorry. Like I said, I'm having had multiple strokes and I have brain damage, so please excuse my wrong wordage. They live stream is the proper word. Their church services every week. So it's great because if you can't get out there to go to church because of the, well, for one, either you don't have a good church in your area and they are hard to find. There are really good churches out there. I just, you know, I live in New York and it was really hard to find a good church. They were all crazy people. But, you know, if you want to get some really good ones, there's some great ones down south. Man, I wish I lived down there. That's some real good down-home preaching, okay? But a couple of people, and there's a really good one in Hawaii, and there's one, believe it or not, in California, but this brother, he does this because he knows that there's people in California that need it desperately. And so he's living out there where nobody wants to live right now just so that he can share the gospel with people. So I'll share some of these people. They're really, they've been a big blessing to me. And a lot of them have explained stuff with that are really easy to understand. And with me, with my brain damage and stuff, I had two really bad car accidents with that injury. And I have MS and that's doing brain damage. And I have multiple strokes, all kinds of stuff. It's a wonder that I'm speaking to you today, okay? So I really needed people to explain stuff to me in a way that was easy, okay? Because it was confusing. When you start to read the Bible yourself, it's a little bit confusing. So it really helped to have somebody who has studied it for years to explain it to me in a way that I could understand. And so rather than you bop around trying to find people and getting, you know, off track and deceived by even more people that will confuse you, I'm going to save you that time and give you a list of people that I have tried. Not that that's the only people out there, but I'm hoping that, you know, at least this would give you a good start of people to help you grow in your walk. Okay, so anyways, thank you for listening to my long spiel, and maybe I'll see you here again. Maybe I'll see you in heaven if we get raptured soon, which I believe is any day, okay? Any day. Either way, I'll be seeing you guys. Bye-bye.